Facebook is just... Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome, welcome to PTPOG, Practicing the Presence of God. Pastor Michael Hayes back with you this Monday morning. I know you missed me on yesterday. I missed you as well. Had some meetings on yesterday, but God is good. Anyhow, welcome to PTPOG. I am Pastor Michael Hayes, pastor of the Hillcrest Seventh-day Adventist Church here in beautiful downtown Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We are excited and glad and elated to have you with us this morning. You know, I've had a few trouble. By the way, if you get a chance, go ahead and share and like this right now, this video. Go ahead and share this video right now on your live feed and also like it if you would. Leave a comment if you would, if you like what you're hearing and what you're seeing, and we appreciate you. If you like this on YouTube, please like this video on YouTube and also join us in our ministry family, if you would, by subscribing to our channel on YouTube, hashtag PTPOG, Practicing the Presence of God. Listen, I had some trouble getting on today because once again, Facebook has changed the rules. I don't know what they're doing. I have no idea, but they've changed the apparatus for us to be able to get online from Zoom. I'm actually launching this from my Zoom account. And so I had some trouble getting on today. So I don't even know if this is really going live, if you're actually hearing me. If you're hearing me, let me know. If everything seems okay and all right, let me know. It forced me to post to my personal page, and I had to launch it from my personal page to the PTPOG page on Facebook. So, you know, I don't know what's going on. I'm going to try to figure this out. They've changed the algorithms and whatever else they did, the software. So we got to figure that out. But anyway, I digress. Thank you for being with us today. I pray that the Lord has blessed you throughout the weekend. We had a blessed weekend. Had a powerful, powerful, power-packed message from an awesome pastor, preacher, Pastor Elisha Jones from the Erie, Pennsylvania, Blessed Hope Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we really appreciate her being with us. If you get a chance, check that out on our Hillcrest SDA Church page. You will not be disappointed. She gave us an incredible message from the Word of God. Amen. So today we're going to get into the Word today. But before we do, I want to say that please pray for us here in Pittsburgh. On yesterday, within a 12-hour period, we had three different shootings in three different locations here in the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So, we need to be lifted up. We need you guys to pray for us. And pray for our city, pray for the people in our city. Really, people are really starting to lose their faculties and lose their patience and their peacefulness, their sense of belonging and everything else as a result of this pandemic and just being tied up and locked up in the house and all this kind of stuff. And just people really are literally losing their faculties. I mean, I'm just being honest with you. So please pray for us. One of those shootings was a fatal shooting. Several people were a part of those shootings. So please, please keep us in your prayers. We really appreciate your prayers and your support today. Let's get into our word this morning, which is found in the book of Psalm, division 34, I believe. Psalm division 34, and we are looking here at verse number, let me see what verse we're looking at. We're looking at verse number 14. That's Psalm division 34. And we're looking at verse number 14. Let's go ahead and read this together. Psalms 34:18 says this, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord, he is good," or "that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts or trusteth in him." Today, we're speaking from the subject, taste for yourself. Taste it for yourself. Let's bow our heads for a brief word of prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for your blessings and your kindness towards us. We love you, Lord, and we know that you love us because we're still alive. We're still alive and we're still here. We're still blessed. We still have the ability to think for ourselves. We still have the ability to walk, talk, and move. So, Lord, we know you love us, and we thank you so much, and we appreciate you today. Oh, God, we lift up your name, and we pray in a special way that, Lord, you would be with us, empower us, invigorate us. Please be, Lord, with the families of the victims of these three shootings that took place here in Pittsburgh. Please be with us here in this city today. And forward, oh God, please let your spirit lead and guide and help people to come to understand that your love for them surpasses all. Bless us today and give us this day our daily bread in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. This is one of my favorite texts in all the Bible. I love quoting this text because it is such a powerful text. And I think it signifies the nature of the response to God that he's looking for from us. God is looking for us to taste and see. You know, whenever my wife cooks, and my wife cooks not all the time, but quite often. She's probably the biggest cook in the house. I cook as well, but she mostly cooks most of the time. And, you know, and she often tries new recipes or new things. She likes to add, you know, my wife doesn't like to be a boring cook. She doesn't like to be boring at anything, really. But especially in her cooking, she just does not like to do the same thing over and over again. And so what she does is she'll go to the store and she'll find some new recipe or some new food that maybe we've never even tried before, some new vegetable, fruit, or whatever the case may be, put together a recipe, and she will cook it. And what she will say when she's done cooking it, you know, she will come and she will say, "Listen, I want you guys to try this," and she'll give it to us, whatever that new recipe might be. And she always asks, my wife always does this, she always asks, "How is it? How is it? What do you think? What do you think?" She needs to know our response. Taste it. Have you tasted it yet? It's important to taste it. It's important to experience it. And it's the same way with a relationship with God. You've got to taste and see. You've got to put yourself, involve yourself in a relationship with God. And gaining knowledge of the Lord that he gives to us is actually our gaining of knowledge from him or about him, of him, is for the development of a relationship. We're not here to get knowledge of God just for our mental education. God doesn't reveal himself to us so that we can go around bragging to other people about how much we know about God or how much of a vision we got from God, or, you know, that's not why we're trying to get to know who God is. That's not why we're gaining knowledge of him. But we do it because we want to build a constructive, strong, powerful, invigorating relationship with him, because that's what he wants with us. That's why he reveals himself. That's why he shares himself. You know, when you are involved in a relationship, what do? You expose more and more of yourself to the other person. That's how you become intimate and close. And eventually, if you're in a dating situation and you're moving on to a marriage relationship, that's what marriage is really all about. It's about this incredible amount of intimacy, of exposure of oneself to somebody else. Come on, say amen. The Bible tells us that we, in fact, are married to Jesus. We're married to God. Come on, say amen. We are, amen, the wife of God, if you will, in terms of an analogy, analogous. We are his wife. He is our husbandman. He is taking care of us. And he is revealing more and more of himself as the husband of the relationship, so to speak. And he asks us to do the same. It's called intimacy. Intimacy. The exposure of oneself to another. Intimacy. That's what it's about. This is what God is doing when he's revealing more and more of himself to us. He doesn't just reveal himself so we can go around talking about all the stuff we know about him. No, he wants us to experience him. He desires for us to know him personally in a relationship that is profound and deeply, deeply intimate. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 and 3 tell us something significant. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 and 3 tell us this. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through, watch this, through the knowledge of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and unto godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue. Somebody say glory to God. So watch this. Watch what we receive as a result of coming into a deeper knowledge of God. We get grace. We receive peace multiplied unto us. Come on, say amen. Not just ordinary grace and peace. No, we get it exponentially multiplied in our lives through the knowledge of God. Watch this. And verse 3 says, according to this incredible divine power that is working in us, through the knowledge of God, we also receive everything we need that pertains to life and godliness. Isn't that something? In other words, our whole lives, amen, become purposed now in the knowledge of who God is. You gain your purpose and your understanding, your approach to life, your reason for living, when you and I come into a deeper knowledge of God. And doesn't that just stand to reason that that would make sense? Since he is our source, since he is our creator, it would stand to reason that us understanding and coming into a deeper knowledge of who he is would in fact give us purpose and reason for life. It would give us a foundation for our lives. It would show us exactly why we're here and what our purpose is. It just makes total sense. Come on, say amen this morning. And so as we come to know God and know the Lord, his goodness starts, watch this, it starts shedding off onto us. You know, it's kind of like when you hang out with certain people, they tell you birds of a feather flock together, right? Because when you hang out with people, eventually you start acting like them. You start walking like them. You start dressing like them. You start looking like them. If you hang out with them long enough, you it's almost like you become family almost. And when they see you, they see the other person. When they see the other person, they see you. you know, and so on and so forth. And eventually, you know, as I say, if you become married, and how many of you have seen husbands and wives that they start looking alike after a while? They just, I mean, they look like brother and sister after a while. They literally start looking alike. It's amazing. It's like, did you all look like that when you first got together? You know, no. But living with one another, you influence each other. Come on, say amen. And that's what it's like with God. When we start walking with God, when we start understanding and coming into a knowledge of who he is, his goodness starts shedding on us, if you will. It starts coming into our lives. The Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord, he is good. He is good. Not everything is good. Come on, say amen. Not everything is good, and not everybody is good. You know, a lot of people, you know, when you meet them, they appear to be good on the external veneer of who they are. But after a while, when you get to know them, somebody in here knows what I'm talking about. When you come to know them, when you come to understand who they really are, you come to see the different decisions that they make, personal decisions in their life, you start to realize this person is not who I anticipated them to be. They are not good as I thought they were, but not with God. With God, he just becomes, if I can coin a phrase, more gooder. Come on, say amen. He just becomes more gooder to you. He comes, you get to see the deepness of his goodness, of his grace, his mercy, his loving kindness, his patience, his long suffering, huh? His mercifulness. You come to find out he's just full of goodness. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. He is merciful. He is kind. He is magnanimous. He is gracious. He is patient. The scriptures, saints of God, abound with declarations of God's goodness. Look with me here at Psalm 107 in verse number 1. Psalm division 107 in verse number 1 says this, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Somebody say hallelujah. God will never stop being merciful. He's always merciful in all his works, in all his actions. In every choice and decision that he makes, he is merciful forever. Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. Notice with me, Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse number 14. Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse number 14 says, and I will satiate the soul of the priests with fatness, and my people shall be satisfied with my goodness, saith the Lord. Come on, say amen out here. My people shall be satisfied with my goodness. Oh, bless God. That's Jeremiah 34, verse 14. 31, excuse me, Jeremiah 31, verse 14. What an amazing statement that is. Can you be satisfied with somebody's goodness? You can with God's, according to the word of God. Yes, you can be satisfied. You can be filled with God's goodness. So how does a person experience this so-called goodness, Pastor Hayes? How do you experience it? How do you lock into it? How do you come about getting this experience of God's goodness in your life? How does that happen? The Bible says, blessed is the man who trusts in him. Our scripture reading this morning. Blessed is the one who trusts in him. Psalm 34, verse 18. God's goodness is available for our personal experience whenever we trust him. I'm going to say that again. God's goodness is available to be experienced whenever you and I decide to trust him. When we decide to trust him, his goodness becomes readily apparent in our lives. When you decide to lean on the Lord and not on your own understanding, and in every one of your ways, you begin to acknowledge his presence, his power, his grace, his peace, his patience in your life, now you begin to experience God. You see, you have to trust him. It's like this. It's like I told you, my wife makes these different dishes all the time and comes and says, have you tasted it yet? Have you tasted it yet? Watch this, watch this, watch this, watch what I'm about to tell you now. And I say, well, baby, I haven't tasted it yet. Well, go ahead and eat it. Go ahead and eat it. Go ahead and taste it. And see, in order for me to taste, watch this now. In order for me to taste this new thing that I've never even seen before, never even heard before, this new dish that she has created with her own hands, I have to trust my wife. Come on, say amen. I've got to trust my wife. I've got to trust that she didn't put any poison in there. Come on, say amen, and try to get some of the insurance, and her and the kids go off into the wonderful, beautiful yonder. Come on, say amen. I've got to trust that my wife loves me and that my wife cares about me, amen, and that she's not going to give me something that she herself would not eat and that she would not give me something that she didn't believe was good for me. Come on, say amen. I've got to trust the woman who made it for me. In the same way, if you're going to try God, if you're going to, watch this, if you're going to taste God, you're going to have to trust him. You're going to have to trust him. You're going to have to trust God. You've got to lean on God. You've got to make some decisions according to his word. You've got to lean not to your own understanding. You're going to have to trust God in situations where you know you don't have any control. Come on, say amen. You're going to have to trust God where you can't trace him, where you can't see the end from the beginning, where you just have to say, you know what, Lord, I know you told me to do this. I know you spoke to my spirit by way of your word. I know you told me that this is where you want me to go. This is what you want me to do. So I'm just going to trust you right now. I can't see it. I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't know how it's going to take place. It doesn't make sense to me, but you said it. I know you said it. I know you spoke to me, so I'm going to trust you. I know you've set this table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup is going to run over. I'm going to believe it. I don't know how it's going to happen, but you have set this table before me. You've put this plate in front of me, God. So I'm going to go ahead and trust you and eat from it. Come on, say amen. And many of you right now are in the midst of a decision of trust. You need to trust God for something. I don't know what it is, but you do. God has been speaking to you, and he's asking you to trust him. He's asking you to trust in his character. He's asking you to trust in the fact that he loves you. And in your knowledge of him, you know that he's not going to lead you in a destructive direction. And so God is asking you to trust him. No, you can't see the end from the beginning. No, you can't see how it's going to happen. But God is asking you to trust him. And he says, you shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living if you trust me now. That's what God is saying. He's saying that to you right now. Notice with me, Psalm, amen, 31 and verse 19. Psalm division 31 and verse 19 says this, oh, how great is thy goodness, Lord, which thou hast laid up for them that fear thee, which thou hast wrought for them or worked for them that trust in thee before the sons of men. Those who put their trust in you as an example for other people to see, oh, you're going to work the goodness in them that they can't work for themselves. That's what the Bible is saying. They're going to experience your good character. Those who trust in the Lord. Are you ready to trust in the Lord today? Are you ready to trust in the direction that he's trying to and seeking and been pondering, trying to lead you for so long, and you have said no over and over again? Are you ready to say yes to God today? Notice with me Isaiah 26 and verse 3, our last text, next to the last text. Isaiah 26 and verse number 3. Isaiah 26 and verse number 3 says this: you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. You see all these people out here toting guns and taking people's lives and just losing their minds. They're just going crazy. You know why? Because they don't trust in the Lord. They don't trust in the Lord. Many of them don't even know there is a Lord to trust in. Are you listening to me today? You know the reason why I haven't gone back crazy during this time with all this foolishness out here, all this craziness going on, shooting and killing and stabbing and robbing and lying and racism and sexism and every kind of other ism out here. You know why I haven't lost my mind? Because I have learned that I can trust in the Lord and he will give me peace. A peace that passes all understanding. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. And it's not cliche. It's not just a cliche. It's not just something people say. It's for real. It's for real. Because I will tell you, if I did not know the Lord and I did not seek to lean on him and trust in him and hear his word and listen to his word and apply his word in my life, I guarantee you I would not. Oh my goodness. My mind would not be where it is today, that's for sure. I don't know where I would be. Can somebody testify and say, Lord, without you, I don't know where I would be? Can somebody testify to that today? Here's our last text for the morning. It's found in the book of Lamentations, chapter 3 and verse number 25. Jeremiah, the prophet, writes this to us. Lamentations, chapter 3. And verse number 25 declares this: the Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul who seeks after him. Are you seeking the Lord today? I know you are, because you're watching this morning. If you're watching this morning, you are seeking the Lord. And I want you to know that the Lord is going to be good and is being good to you even right now as you're watching. He's going and he is being good to you right now. And he says, I'm going to impart unto you my peace that passes all understanding, a peace that nobody can really figure out where it's coming from. I'm going to impart my peace to you. I'm giving my peace to you. My peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. Not as the world giveth, giveth I unto you. That's what Jesus said in John chapter 14. My peace I leave with you. So here's my admonition for you this morning. Taste for yourself. Huh? Come on, taste it for yourself. Taste the Lord and see that he truly is good by learning to trust in him with everything in your life. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your loving kindness. Thank you, Lord, just for being good. This is who you are. In fact, the word good comes from the word God. We know you are good, and we bless your name, Lord. We ask right now, Lord, please impart your peace, your patience to us. Impart your loving kindness. Lord, shed your goodness over onto us so that we might exhibit the same characteristics in our lives that you, Lord, exhibit. Thank you, God, for your grace in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. God be with you. God bless you today. I know you've been blessed. Please like this and share this on your Facebook page or even on YouTube. Like it if you would. Hit the notification bell so you'll know when we get new videos. And please subscribe to our YouTube channel. God be with you. God bless you. Have a great and marvelous day. And please remember, taste him and see. And you will find that he truly, truly is the only one who is good. God bless you. We love you, saints. Take care. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.